In this video, we're computing the magnetic field on the axis of a circular loop of current where the current is I and the radius of the loop is big R. So on the left, we have a face-on view of the loop showing a small increment of length, and that's called dl vector, where the direction of dl is the direction of current in the loop. Then we look at this loop in perspective, so dl is coming out at us, and that's indicated by a dot inside a circle at the top of the loop. And notice I is going down here on the side of the loop closest to us. And then at the bottom of the loop, we show an X inside a circle, meaning that DL and I are pointing into the page at the bottom of the loop. We've also labeled an observation point at a distance of S from the center of the loop and lying on the loop's axis. Now to calculate the magnetic field due to this current loop, we're going to use the Biot-Savart law. And that's what the Biot-Savart law looks like in differential form, and I'll post a link to the video where that was first derived. So to use the Biot-Savart law, we need to have a position vector in our diagram, and that's a vector pointing from the source charge in dl to the observation point. And the magnitude of that is just r, that's the r in the Biot-Savart law. Next, we want to draw a unit vector in the same direction as r, and that's what we call r hat. Now, just a reminder, what we mean by a unit vector is a vector of length 1. So this is going to capture the direction of r, but it has a length of 1. So the magnetic field contribution takes a direction given by the cross product of dl into r hat. And to get that direction, we have to orient our right hand so we can sweep our fingers inward from the direction of dl to the direction of r hat. So we have to sweep our fingers from going straight out of the page to pointing in the direction of r hat. And this means our thumb lies in the page and points at an angle like this. And note there that the result of a cross product is always perpendicular to each of the participant vectors. So this little magnetic field contribution, dB, is at right angles to the position vector, as we can see in the diagram. And it lies in the page, which makes it perpendicular to dl, as well, because dl points out of the page. So we end up with this magnetic field contribution pointing off at this weird angle, and we need to add up all the contributions coming from every dl around the ring. Fortunately, there's a symmetry to this problem. Every single dl, giving us a dB like we saw in our original cross product, is going to be matched with a dl on the opposite side of the ring. And when we do this, we get a small magnetic field contribution that has exactly the opposite off-axis component. So those vertical components in our diagram are going to cancel each other out, and the horizontal components in the end are going to be the only survivors of adding up all the contributions around the ring. So this means all we really need to add up is all the X contributions to the total magnetic field at the observation point. So this X component, dB sub X, can be written in terms of the cosine of an angle that we'll call theta. And then our little contribution to the total field at the observation point is just a dB cosine theta. But now we need to relate cosine theta to the parameters of the problem. So this is a little bit tricky, but familiar at this point. I see theta plus 90 degrees plus this angle has to equal 180 degrees. And that means this angle is 90 minus theta. So that when I add it to theta, I get 90 degrees. But this is a right triangle, meaning this angle up here in the corner has to add to 90 degrees with 90 minus theta. That means this angle up in the corner is theta itself. So theta plus 90 minus theta gives me 90. Now we can relate the cosine of theta to the dimensions in our diagram. And the cosine of theta is just going to be adjacent over hypotenuse, which would be big R divided by the magnitude of our position vector, little r. And we'll go ahead and do that inside of our Biot-Savart calculation. So now we're ready to start setting up our integral. And what we're going to do is try to get an expression for dbx, that's a horizontal contribution due to a single dl. And notice without the vector over the top of that, I'm talking about the magnitude of dbx. And when I add up all the contributions from all the way around the ring, each one of those is responsible for a rightward pointing dbx. And when I add a bunch of vectors that point in the same direction, all I have to do is add their magnitudes. So at this point, we're going to drop the vectors in our calculation. So I need an expression for dbx, and that's going to be the magnitude of dB multiplied by the cosine of theta. So I have mu naught over 4 pi. I'll go ahead and move the I out here with these constants. And then I need the magnitude of dl crossed into r hat, And that's just the product of the magnitudes of those two vectors. That's dl times the magnitude of r hat, which is 1, so I don't even have to write that, times the sine of the angle between them. So what's the angle between dl and r hat? Well, dl points out of the page, and r hat is in the page, so the angle between them is 90 degrees. So I end up with a sine of 90 in there, which just reduces to 1. So then we have to divide by the magnitude of r squared. And since r is the hypotenuse of a right triangle, I can just write this as the sum of the squares of the two legs. So that gives me big R squared plus S squared. Now at the same time, we're gonna take just the horizontal component of this contribution. We want dBx, and that's dB times the cosine of theta. So now it's time to get the cosine of theta into our formula in terms of the parameters of the problem. So there's our theta, and the cosine of that is the adjacent over the hypotenuse, which is going to be big R divided by the length of our position vector little r. And again, just using the Pythagorean theorem, that's the square root of big R squared plus S squared. So now everything is constant here except for dl. So we can start moving all the constants out in front. I have mu naught I times big R over 4 pi times the quantity R squared plus S squared. That's a big R there, which is a constant. It's just the radius of the ring. And this is raised to the 3/2 power. And the only variable piece of this integral is our leftover little dl. So now we can add up all these horizontal contributions to the total magnetic field at the observation point. And that's the answer to the problem, bx. That's going to be the sum of all the contributions, the dbx's. And that's what an integral does. It's just a summation device for infinitely many differential contributions. And we're in luck on this integral because practically everything is just a constant. I'm going to move all the constants out in front. I have mu naught I times big R over 4 pi big R squared plus S squared to the 3/2 power times the integral of dl. Now we just have to add up all these length increments until we get all the way around the ring. So just choosing some arbitrary point to start with and calling that 0, we want to add up dl's all the way from 0 to 2 pi r. That's the circumference of the ring. And integrating dl just gives me l. I evaluate across the limits of integration, and the contribution from this whole integral is just 2 pi r. So we just end up with an extra 2 pi r tacked onto the numerator. Now we can start doing some simplification. I can cancel a factor of 2 pi, leaving me with a leftover 2 in the denominator. And I can put my r's together in the numerator. I end up with a mu naught I r squared divided by 2 times the quantity big R squared plus S squared, all raised to the 3/2 power. So now we have a general expression for the magnetic field on the symmetry axis of a ring of current. And one of the natural limiting cases to explore here is when S goes to 0. So if we travel to the center of this ring, the S down there in the denominator is going to go away, and I end up with just an R squared to the 3/2 down there. But r squared to the 3/2 is just r cubed. So now we can cancel out two of those factors of r. And this leaves me with just a single r in the denominator. And we've obtained a useful formula for the magnetic field at the center of a ring of current. It's just mu naught I over 2r. In the next video, we use the Biot-Savart law to directly compute the magnetic field at the center of this ring. And hopefully the answer agrees with what we just found in the small s limit here. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left when it's done, and I'll see you there.